So in New Jersey, we use the New Jersey Choice Tool, which is the inter-RI or inter-RAI assessment. And RAI stands for Resident Assessment Instrument. I just learned that this tool, along with the minimum data set, was developed by the same company, which is used in New Jersey. The New Jersey Choice is a modified version of the inter-RAI home care tool. And home care is one of a series of integrated assessment tools used to identify individuals' needs as well as their strengths and preferences. And you have probably seen this and are aware of it. There are algorithms that go with which guide individualized care plans and services. So in the Division of Aging Services, we have the Office of Community Choice Options, or OCO, which is responsible for clinical assessment for nursing facility level of care, determination, and authorization. And this is a PASS, pre-admission screening. We have NJ Choice used for case organizations, for aging discipline resource connections, and three designated counties, Warren, Austin, and Atlantic. And it's also used by managed care organizations. Now I'm going to talk about the pre-admission screening and resident review, or PASSR, which is a function that is entered in my office, at least part of it is. As I said, the first part, I'll first go into a little history and talk about generally how this developed. There is a federal law requiring all 50 states to have a PASSR system in place to determine whether individuals can have their needs met in the nursing facility. And all Medicaid certified nursing facilities are required to have the PASSR done regardless of payer source if they are Medicaid certified nursing facilities. They actually cannot admit an individual with serious mental illness, intellectual disability, or related conditions unless the individual has been properly screened, evaluated, appropriate for nursing home placement. And this actually all grew out of a major law that a bill that was passed in 1987, the Omnibus Budget Reconciliation Act, 87, or OBRA 87. And this was a major law that brought the form of nursing home care, quality care of nursing homes within a number of things, including reduced restraint use, used to use of chemical restraints or psychiatric medications, and it also brought on the PASSR process, as well as other functions to improve the care of individuals in nursing homes. And at the time, or before this, there had been a number of individuals who worked in nursing homes who had serious mental illness or developmental intellectual disability. And their needs were not able to be met in the nursing facility. So this was recognized as an important change in the process. So you see here the intent of PASSR is to protect individuals, these individuals from inappropriate placement in the nursing facility. And in New Jersey, we have state regulations, as mentioned here. Now, the NJC 885 was actually just being revised. And as of July, there are new regulations that will change the process a little bit. And I'll just go into some of that as that relates to the process that we have for the state. So again, just an overview. It's a collaborative process, PASSR, between several divisions, three divisions. Division of Aging Services in terms of the OCO, the Division of Mental Health and Addiction, and the Division of Developmental Disabilities. I'm going to go into the different levels here just briefly of CASR. You can refer to level one and level two. So the two components, the level one, has actually got two aspects to it. One is determining whether an individual meets the level of care, their needs meet that of the level of care of a nursing facility, and also to screen them for a serious mental illness or an intellectual or developmental disorder. And if they screen positive, then they're required to go on to the level two evaluation, depending on whether it's positive for mental illness or for IDD. Both divisions have separate processes for these, and both of the mental health and developmental disabilities both make that determination based on evaluations that are done. So for mental health, if the screen, which is a very brief screen with just relatively few questions, determines that a major mental illness is present, a level two CASR is required. And this requires an independent psychiatric evaluation to determine whether the mental health needs of the individual can be met in a nursing facility or whether the individual requires specialized services and can't be admitted to a nursing facility. And as mentioned here, the level two psych evaluation requires an independent psychiatrist or psychiatric APM to complete the CASR psychiatric evaluation. Now, I will mention on exceptions because there are sometimes when individuals living at home and don't, are not in psychiatric care, we have allowed the family physician to complete this when there is an indication that needs to be done. But that's the exception. So specialized services, when we say a person needs or doesn't need specialized services. In New Jersey, this refers to inpatient psychiatric care. All of the states have different criteria, but in New Jersey, this is the criteria. It isn't in a number of other states. And of course, it's a fairly low bar to meet. It means that the person doesn't need 24/7 medical supervised care, psychiatric care. It doesn't, of course, mean if the person doesn't, that they still could get all of their needs at the nursing facility, but it does mean that, at least as far as in the CASR level two process, they can't go to a nursing facility. We also have exceptions if the person has a level one screen positive, and I should mention the level one screen basically consists of a few questions related to whether the person has a major mental illness, they've been treated for it, whether they have dementia. And one change that has come about with the new regulations, the revision of the regulations 85 that I mentioned, is that we are no longer requiring everybody who comes from a psychiatric facility to be referred to a nursing home. Be positive for the screen if they have a primary dementia that's documented, clearly documented, and those needs override the psychiatric. The reason we made the change, and this had been in place years ago, but we made the change because we see that there are a number of individuals who reside in nursing homes who have brief psychiatric hospitalizations, basically because of behavioral changes related to their dementia, and they don't really have significant mental illness, but because of the commitment law and everything else, they are deemed to have a mental illness because they meet the behavioral requirements. So we are saying if an individual has clearly documented dementia, not just by a score on any mental status exam or something that is a clinical impression, it really has to be documented, and they're they're going from a psych hospital, they still will not be screened positive in the future. This takes place July 1st. That's the major change, at least from the level two process. The forms are also different, but that's the major change from this revision, for our passing process. Okay, so I'm getting back to these categorical determinations. If an individual meets one of these four categorical determinations, they don't have to have a level two evaluation. And this is someone, because they obviously need nursing home care, someone with a terminal illness, they have less than 6 months to live by definition, severe physical illness, there are specific criteria for that. Respite care, this is for only up to 30 days. And then protective services, which is can be provided very quickly on the weekends, and it's only up to 7 days. Care in a nursing facility for those who need protective services will be moved for short term to find another place. So these are just some of the categorical exceptions. And then, now going to the level two PASR done by Developmental Disabilities Division. This is a little different. They have different criteria. Of course, their criteria relates around skill deficits and specialized training needs of the resident, as can only be provided by staff that have, skills needed to work with people with intellectual and developmental disabilities. Even if individuals are not known to DD or previously determined ineligible, the services of the level two evaluation is handled by staff in their intake and eligibility unit, consultation with a nurse with developmental disabilities. The nurse completes the level two evaluation for individuals that are already determined eligible services. The level two for individuals residing in a state developmental center may involve collaboration between the center's nursing staff, social services, and the resident living units to complete this process. Now, DD has, in addition to the four categorical categories I mentioned, they have an additional one, which is for someone with dementia with a diagnosis of IBD. In the OBRA 87 Act, there was also a requirement not only for PASR prior admission to a nursing home, but an annual resident review to determine whether they still could reside and receive adequate care in a nursing facility. This has been changed in recent years. It is not required annually, but it still is required if there is a significant change in the physical, medical, behavioral condition, whether the person proves or actually declines, that they have to complete a resident review. And similar to when the pre-admission screening is done, we evaluate the changes. If they no longer can stay in the nursing facility because, say, their behavioral condition has worsened and they cannot manage them because of their behavioral issues, we are required to try to seek some assistance. Oftentimes, we don't get too many of these because oftentimes people in nursing facilities go to a screening center to get admitted, and so they're no longer in the nursing home, and when they come out of the hospital, then they pass our maybe done. But the other issue here is if someone improves and no longer needs nursing home level care, then there needs to be a plan put together for treatment in another setting. And another change in the minimum data set can also trigger the need for a resident. Okay. So again, a little bit more about it. Resident review determines whether the individual requires different or additional mental health or DD-related services. Now, we do have in New Jersey some nursing homes that specialize in behavioral care of residents. One of these specialties, NIPS, and I think there's only around 140 beds statewide for facilities that actually provide, and they get an increase per diem rate to provide this care. However, there also are a number of nursing facilities that don't get a special rate, or they're not technically screened, but we provide more specialized behavioral health services for individuals in, for nursing, as a nursing home. I mentioned here, replacing less restrictive setting is based on the residency. It seems that the referral for evaluation, MOPS, okay, so we're going to have a case related to this issue. But just going to go on a couple slides here to talk about something we mentioned earlier, the DSM-5 and the ICD-9-10, the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual, 5th edition, came out this year, and been a lot of controversy. And this is produced by the American Psychiatric Association, and it is generally the classification system that most behavioral health specialists utilize, because it actually not only has research behind it, it describes, provides criteria for various mental health and substance use disorders. But it also, as I said, provides detail, whereas the classification system that is used internationally, the ICD, currently, it's in the 10th edition. They're moving on to the 11th international, although the United States, we're still utilizing ICD-9. This has a variety of medical and behavioral health diagnoses in it. And this does not provide the description or, you know, some of the other information that the DSM provides. But of course, it is essential for fulfilling purposes. It was hoped that the DSM-5, since the ICD-10 is supposed to come out this October, and there's a consistency between the two, where the DSM-5 diagnoses had a crosswalk, or at least some information about what the ICD-10 diagnosis will be. Now with the delay in the ICD-10, it's put off to at least next year because of a part of the bill that was passed in Congress to increase physician Medicare rates. So it's not clear what's going to happen with that. So it seems like in our division, at least elsewhere, there's a little confusion about how we should move ahead with DSM-5, considering there's a great impetus right now to do that because of the delay with the ICD-10. But still, we are moving ahead with training and trying to get the clinicians and others aware of the changes. Now, Vicki Fresno will just go on to talk about the case of other
folks. So, I'm going to talk a little bit about placement rules. The first is the patient placement criteria from the American Society of Addiction Medicine. The American Society of Addiction Medicine patient placement rule is a standardized tool to determine patient placement in substance abuse treatment at all levels, from detox to residential to outpatient, and it's used widely across the country. And basically, it was an attempt to make standard and consistent, or at least as closely as possible, placements into varying levels of substance abuse treatment. There was a time, I guess the 80s, early 90s, when no matter what level of your what level of your substance abuse or what level of your impairment, everybody went to 28-day rehab. That was the answer for almost everything. I can say that I worked in substance abuse in the 80s and 90s, and you could meet people who went to 5, 10, even 15, 28-day rehab stays, with it being sort of the same over and over again. So this, the American Society of Addiction Medicine developed this tool as a way to have a consistent way to look at placements and understand why somebody would go from one placement, why a person would be assigned or placed in one level of care and not the other. So this tool is about 30 years old, and it took a while to get implemented. It was a real shift in the way people thought about things. used to be, this is my gut feeling, this is what they need, and it's trying to make standard people's gut feelings. So of course, not everybody liked it, but it's taken off and it's used across the country. So that if you're speaking to somebody who understands, treats, runs addiction programs anywhere in the country, and you say, well, you know, we use the ASAP placement criteria to put this person into long-term residential, so they would understand what you were talking about, and they would understand some of the reasons without even meeting the client, what some of the reasons why that person might be placed in that level of care. The LOCUS is a similar tool on the mental health side. We don't, at the Division of Mental Health and Addiction Services, currently use a standardized tool for level of care placements on the mental health only placements, but we will be implementing the LOCUS, the Level of Care Utilization System, across our system. LOCUS is a level of care assessment tool, and it is also now taking off across the country. It was developed by, what is it, community psychiatrists? So Dr. Oz, the American Association of Community Psychiatrists. And they've made it available, widely available, with the hopes of also starting to standardize and make consistent placements for individuals with mental illness into different levels of services, different levels of care. The LOCUS is in it, we're very early in the stages of implementing it. Having experienced the shift in addiction medicine from not having a placement tool to having a placement tool, I know that it takes a long time for the tool to become widely used, to train everybody who has to use it, to make it universal. But we are committed to doing that. It's in our division strategic plan. We have decided to start with the state psychiatric hospitals and the housing providers. And I think last time there were some questions about how the decision is made to place individuals in housing. And this we're hoping to implement as a way to make that standard. The tool is available here at the website. Oops, I'm going to go back. There are some slides missing, but probably when we give you the link, they'll be included, because I wanted to talk just a minute, a little bit about both the LOCUS and the ASAM. The LOCUS and the ASAM are not clinical interview tools. So they are tools that use the results of a clinical interview or assessment, and they use those results to place people in levels of care based on their acuity. The LOCUS calls them domains, the ASAM calls them dimensions, but after a clinical assessment has been done and that information has been collected, then somebody takes that information and looks across these life domains or these life dimensions and to help them decide what kind of services would be the best. In LOCUS, on the mental health side, the dimensions are functional status, comorbidity, recovery environment, engagement, treatment history, and the area that trumps all else, which is harm to self or others. On the substance use disorder side, the dimensions are acute intake, acute intoxication and detox, medical needs, cognitive, behavioral, and emotional needs, readiness or motivation, relapse, and recovery environment. So you can see that the tools sort of take the clinical information and put them into categories to identify the needs along those categories. But I would want to emphasize that the tools are important and they should be used, and they're very, very helpful, but they're not written in stone. So that a lot of times, in factors such as consumer choice, availability of the service, if the LOCUS tool said, this individual needs X, and it wasn't available, well, you wouldn't say, oh, sorry, X isn't available, that's what this tool says you need, so we won't, you know, we've got nothing to give you. Of course, you wouldn't do that. So you may need to look at some other factors, and also clinical decisions. sometimes there are, these are not all of the areas that you may assess somebody on, and a clinical decision would say, this person's sort of, could go either way, and I think they can do fine with a lesser level of care. An example I use when you talk about placement tools is very often in the substance abuse world, we would see women, and their ASAM tool would tell us that they needed to be inpatient. But these women were the only, the primary or the only caregiver to 1, 2, 3, 4 children. And she would say, I can't go inpatient. What would happen to my children? My mother lives, you know, across the country. My husband is an addict. He's very unreliable. I have nobody. I don't want to put them in foster care. I have no place to put them. And before there were mommy and me programs, what we would do then is say, you know what? Really? Is it going to help this woman to go residential and have the rest of her life fall apart? No. So we would figure ways to wrap a lot of services around that woman and keep her in the community so that she didn't lose her home or she didn't lose her children. But she could still have services that she needed to stay, to get and maintain recovery. So the tools are very helpful. They make consistent placements, and they standardize our language and our understanding. But they are tools, and sometimes people override the tools. So I think we have more. We have more, or we have cases. I don't know if it's cases. Mr. F. Oh, I can read Mr. F. Somebody wants to. So Mr. F is a 58-year-old divorced white male who lives in an apartment. He has no family or other supports. He completed high school as a special ed student. He quit working 7 years ago due to severe arthritis in his knee and shoulder, and he's on Social Security disability. Mr. F's medical history is significant for arthritis, diabetes, and hypertension. He has an anxiety disorder, a depressive disorder, and a history of alcohol abuse. He has had 2 psychiatric hospitalizations for depression and anxiety, and he quit drinking 7 years ago. So he quit drinking a year before he stopped working. Until recently, he was able to take his medications and take care of himself in his own apartment and attend outpatient services. He has been experiencing more severe depression, increasing pain, and limited mobility. He's unable to cook, do housework, shop, and he requires assistance with his toileting. He also needs help with his medications. He would like to stay in his apartment, but his healthcare providers are concerned about his decrease in physical and psychiatric functioning and have suggested he go to a nursing home. So, I don't know if anybody has any thoughts about how to address Mr. M's concerns, or Mr. S's concerns.
Anybody like to comment and make a recommendation? Should this individual go into a nursing home? Are there alternatives?
Probably would be helpful if his medication history was reviewed to see seems to be having some difficulty doing that. So you'll want to make sure that he's actually taking his medication and that he's stable on it. Perhaps that would reduce the emotional swings. The other thing is that perhaps once those are stabilized, one could consider some type of in-home supports that he could be evaluated for.
Anybody else?
About the psychiatric?
Care management.
He's going to be facing these kinds of cases.
Right.
So it says that he's in an outpatient program. I'm assuming that's an outpatient behavioral health program, right? But his depression is becoming more severe. So you may want to get an understanding, either speak with the outpatient program, get another psychiatric diagnosis, evaluation for a diagnosis, but it sounds like that is as or more significant than the physical health issues.
And depending on where he lives, maybe there might be access to early intervention support services, the EAS program we talked about in day one, or intensive outpatient treatment supports, an IOP program. To get, you know, services more intensely to try to avoid potential hospitalization.
Right, so I don't know if everybody heard Roger, but he was saying that maybe a more intensive outpatient could be as little as once a week. So maybe something more intensive to address the psychiatric illnesses could help stabilize him and eliminate the need for any kind of residential service. And there's IOTSS, there's EIS. So there's intensive outpatient services and supports, which takes outpatient services and wraps additional help around those services. And there's early intervention and support services for individuals who may be looking like they're getting increasingly ill, and we want to keep them, we want to divert them from the hospitals. So there are resources to help individuals stay in the home, but get the psychiatric services that they need and the behavioral health services.
Yeah, I was just going to say, this reminds me of, we've seen individuals referred who have some psychiatric issues that they're losing, where they can't stay in their apartment, they have to replace. They often will end up in the hospital because they can't return home. If they get screened, or particularly if they have any depression that suggests they may have some suicidal ideation. And that, but if they don't need a hospital, they can be provided with intensive outpatient services, and they can at least find some alternative housing that meets their needs, which we're hoping, will be occurring in the future, that's a much better alternative for an individual like this.
Any other thoughts about Mr. F?
Since he's 58, he's 55 and older, if he meets a nursing facility level of care, he may be a candidate for PACE if he lives within the geographic area of the PACE sites. Because they could, transportation is available, they pick them up and bring them to the site. That would help with other things.
Okay. Oh, Molly?
So I just want to make one more comment because, thank you. So I'm reading this, and it's not the first time I've read this case, and didn't really think about it until today's discussion that, I'm looking, maybe others are not doing this, I'm looking at the case, I'm thinking about his problems and his challenges. And if I look a little more closely, I see that this is an individual who has tremendous strengths and resources and has in the past done some very difficult things, successfully, and he's maintained his abstinence from alcohol for 8 years, and that just want to think about the extent to which we look at the strengths and capabilities that individuals have in their circumstances, as well as the challenges and the limitations. And in working with him, I think maybe want to really draw on and, you know, use as a frame of reference how he has been able to manage other difficulties in his life very successfully. And probably when he, well, maybe not necessarily, but more than likely when he stopped drinking, he had help from other people and other support, and to sort of put his current situation in that context as well. And that with the right kind of support, he would be able to really maintain the independence, which is so tremendously important to him and probably the source of much of his anxiety and depression, so.
I think it also, you know, I think this could be, this current inability to care for himself is very much related to his depression. And if he were his baseline, as you say, with all the strength he has, he possibly could take care of him. So it would be, I think unfortunately, we see that people being referred to, you know, a nursing home or more restrictive kind of setting when it really is only a, you know, a temporary state where they might, you know, benefit from other alternatives.
My leg fell asleep. My foot fell asleep.
Okay. Should we go on to the next stage? Mr. A. Love it. Mr. A is a 48-year-old single male who is being referred to a nursing home after 6 months' stay in a state psychiatric hospital. He was admitted involuntarily after he had hit a nurse's aide in a nursing facility. So it sounds like he was in a nursing facility, went to a psychiatric hospital, and is also being referred back to a nursing home. He has a diagnosis of major depression and TBI secondary to a motor vehicle accident. He has a seizure disorder for which he takes anticonvulsant. He has a long history of alcoholism. As we learned earlier today, there's a real strong connection between a traumatic brain injury and a substance use disorder. He has been clinically stable on medication and has been considered no longer dangerous, so he's currently on a conditional extension pending placement, CEPP status, meaning he is able to be discharged as soon as an appropriate living arrangement and treatment services in the community can be provided for him. Treatment team has referred him to a nursing facility because they are concerned that he will not continue to take his psychiatric and seizure medications and thinks that he needs supervision. He can perform most ADLs and manage his money and his affairs. Mr. A has expressed a preference for living in his own apartment rather than returning to a nursing facility. Any thoughts about Mr. A?
Talked about the PASR, so if he was referred to nursing home, he would have to have the PASR level 2, addition to level 1, because he has a serious mental illness, and he's being referred to nursing home.
You get the level of care to stay in the nursing facility.
I'd say, if he met level of care for MLTSS, go into a community residential program, brain injury program. There's some that specialize with addiction, and they would make sure he's getting his medication. He would get his behavioral counselors there that he could work with, and they would help him with any ADL needs he might need. Pretty much they could do everything, help him out with all of those areas that he needs help.
So is that a residential program?
Yeah, residential brain injury program.
Yeah. How does a program like PACT play into this? Because he sounds to me like a possible PACT. Mm-hmm.
I'm wondering if PACT is an option for him.
So if he's living in a nursing home.
Not if he's living in a nursing home, or living at home with PACT.
Right, so if he's living on his own, PAC certainly could be a service for somebody. I'm not sure if this case is exactly clear, but they would have to, not adhere with traditional services. So if he's not going to outpatient, refusing, has a long psychiatric history like this is indicating, this PAC would be a potentially appropriate referral for him. But just that folks are clear that PAC is the service. It's not a case management care coordination. You got your psychiatrist, your rehab specialist, it's all bundled into a monthly case rate. So if you're referring to PAC, it's to the exclusion of any other behavioral health services. But he potentially could be appropriate.
Right. These community treatment teams, and it's particularly for people who are refusing care and have a place to live, that's potential.
It's interesting because he can perform his ADLs and manage his money and his affairs.
Yeah, that's what I'm surprising. He's really not appropriate for a nursing home because there's nothing, no service that they're going to give him that he can't already do himself other than medication management, which is not a reason to have him in a nursing home.
Right.
Yeah.
That's a very good point. He wouldn't be a candidate for a nursing home based on because having those skills and abilities to care for stuff like that.
Can he go to a CPCH unit? A lot of nursing homes have them within their facilities, and it's basically they do everything by themselves. It's an independent group at a reduced rate, but they do administer the medication and make sure that they take it. But it's called CPCH. And then there was another thought, if he actually got to the nursing home, even if he doesn't meet that level of care, I'm not sure cognitively if he would meet. There is another new program if you're in a nursing home and you meet criteria and you want to transition back into the community. Center for Independent Living runs it in the area and they will help with getting your security deposit, getting some furniture, clothing, and things like that. But you have to be in a nursing home first. I don't think you can go directly from the psychiatric. That's one of those bumps we would have to work out, but I don't think he can go right from the psychiatric hospital.
It sounds like he was in a nursing home. They sent him for the psychiatric. Maybe the fact that he was living in a nursing home at the time that he ended up being admitted to the psychiatric hospital would make him eligible. Yeah.
Any other comments, recommendations? Okay. Move on.
Okay, now we went to case number 5, Ms. W. Mrs. W, we finally have a woman. We've had all males so far, so the case, we know that women also have mental health, substance use disorders as well, so we want to include that. Mrs. W is a 45-year-old African-American female who lives with her husband and 2 teenage children in a rural area. She was recently placed in a nursing home to assist her to overcome complications she suffered as a result of a stroke. Mrs. W's mental health history is significant for major depression, psychosis, and opioid substance use disorder. She is positive for hepatitis C, which is believed to have been transmitted through her 2-year IV drug use history. She has been on psychotropic medication and has been receiving methadone treatment services for the past 15 years. She would like to be able to return to her family and continue her methadone treatment. Even though she is wheelchair bound, her home is not wheelchair accessible, and her husband is unable to transport her back and forth from the clinic. What types of services might Mrs. W need when and if she returns to her home?
Their house. I mean, there's nowhere near enough information to make them.
come to, so we need to first ask further questions to assess the case. Now, let's say it is a one-floor house and she is able to return. She is, she's not wheelchair. I guess her, she is in the wheelchair, but it's, her house isn't wheelchair accessible, but everything is on the first floor. She only has one step to get up inside the house. What types of services might she need then?
Home modification person.
Okay.
So are you suggesting that, like, one of the first things is to determine whether there's a home modification is feasible, so that changes the picture?
Right.
I think the first thing I definitely is to have an IBC and talk to her support system, because if they're not willing to do these home modifications to have their home modified or to even take her, we don't know they even want her back into that house at this point. So for us to go out and say, we'll do home modifications, and we'll get you this, and we'll get you that, if they don't want her there, all of that is useless. So first, there has to be an IDG.
That is a good point, because it does say she wants to return home.
Right,
it doesn't say what
the
capacity of the family.
She might have put that family through a lot. Maybe
true.
Her children don't want her in that house. We don't know that.
Okay. Any other types of services? If let's say they do want her to return to the home, is there anything we can also help the family with?
Well, normally your contracted providers, your nursing facilities that you have a contract with, prior to the person leaving, they will actually send their occupational physical therapist back to the home to do a home safety check and to see if any modifications are necessary. They can also contact different providers and kind of trace out the cost and things like that. So after that first IBC meeting, the next step is to do almost like a home assessment visit to see what the needs are in the house. And there's many different transport companies that are able to assist someone who is wheelchair bound up and down the stairs. There's different types of lifts and different types of, we're actually looking at getting almost like a wheelchair that lifts itself that can go up a certain amount of steps so you can avoid ramping. So there's a lot of different things out there now.
Right, and I was thinking if she does have Medicaid, also Logisticare is a contracted service that could take her to and from doctor appointments or other therapy. Hey, is there anything else?
I just want to make a point that if all of these folks are on the MLTSS program, number one, each of them has an assigned case manager, care manager, who would have been on top of this since the men were enrolled. So they're up to date on what happened 15 years ago. When she had her stroke, they would have worked with her to get her into, if she can, they would have worked her to get her into subacute nursing facility for rehab. And this would have all been an ongoing process since day one. So they would have an idea. I agree totally with the IUT, having an IUT, but they would have had already an idea, because you would have had a concurrent review nurse taking care of her in the hospital from her stroke, and that concurrent review nurse would have been working with the care manager in the nursing facility. You had your behavioral health administrator and health plan, you know, involved in this from day one. So this should be more of a continuum. But, you know, if there was a question that she could go home, the case manager's already been in her home. She already knows some of the issues. They have already had a New Jersey choice with multiple safety assessments in the home. I just think that putting this in the framework of MLTC or MLTSS, it just makes it a little bit easier to get some of this information, get some of the coordination of care that needs to occur.
And with a husband and two teenage kids at home, there is a potential for a lot of support there that they can help pick up some of the slack.
I And one thing I did want to mention is that there is the Intensive Family Support Services, IFSS, which could obviously help the family work with the situation as they, as the mother comes back to the house. One other thing I was considering as I wrote up this case study was possibly, since we will be implementing behavioral health homes, that would be a possible option as well, since she does have the mental health history as well as hepatitis. She does have a physical ailment that she could possibly be referred to a behavioral health home once those are implemented. Okay, any last thoughts? All right, next on the agenda, it looks like we will be doing public guardianship and adult protective services. And I would like to invite Helen Dodick from the Public Guardian for Elderly Adults, Jennifer Mills from the Statewide Coordinator from Adult Protective Services, and Kathy Cornell, the OPG care manager, up to discuss with us at the state. Thanks.
Hi, everyone. I'm Helen Dodick. My first confession is that I usually have a really strong dark cup of coffee right about this time of day, and if I don't have it, I get really grouchy. So I'm not going to talk that much because you really don't want to hear about me. But the good news is perpetually perky, with or without Kathy, who's going to do a lot of the talking and present both of these programs for you. So this will be a good thing. A couple of just short points I wanted to make as you listen. First, listen for the issue of rights in these two programs, OPG and APS. Who has them? Who doesn't? When they have them, when and if they lose them, focus on rights, and that will be the linchpin of understanding a lot of this. The second issue you want to focus on as you listen is informed consent. Who can consent? What does that mean, informed consent? And what are the issues surrounding that? So that's my two cents on the backdrop of what you should be listening for in order to be educated on these two programs. I'd like to introduce Jennifer Mills in the middle. Jennifer is our statewide coordinator for Adult Protective Services. Both of these women have worked in both programs. Jennifer was our supervisor of care management at the Office of the Public Guardian prior to agreeing to assume the role of statewide coordinator Adult Protective Services about a year ago, I guess it was, right? Kathy Cornell, to her right, is a longtime Adult Protective Services supervisor in Atlantic County who recently joined the Office of the Public Guardian to become a care manager. So in this way, as well as many others, these two programs mirror each other, and you'll see what I'm talking about as soon as Kathy starts presenting.
Hi, everybody. Can you hear me? Before we get started, I just wanted to ask, because I heard that you all, or most of you, some of you, I don't know how many, may have attended a full day training on Office of the Public Guardian and Adult Protective Services. If you did attend that, could you just raise your hand so I can see how many of you really have a pretty comprehensive, okay, so a few, sprinkling. All right, well, we're gonna be very straightforward. We're gonna go through our slides today. We have some, I really want the questions that you have to drive the process of this presentation. So be thinking of questions. We're gonna also look at our case studies as we go. I just did want to echo what Helen said. I have been with APS for 7 years before I moved over to the Office of the Public Guardian. I've been there about 8 months, so I'm the new kid on the block. And we do have the experts here. to field anything that I may not know the answer to today. I think it's an amazing and unique opportunity to have had that experience with Adult Protective Services and now be working directly in the field as a care manager for the Office of the Public Guardian, because one kind of does hand off to the other oftentimes. So a very informal presenter. I want you to, like I said, be thinking of questions. I like to use examples, and a lot of them, of course, are examples I've experienced. So I want to draw from that today, too. And just briefly, too, before I get right into the slides, the Office of the Public Guardian, the acting public guardian, of course, is Helen Dodd. My impression, starting there, the cornerstones of the program, for me, that I've observed, have been a team approach, which is critical, and I'll explain a little bit more about that. Individualized care, and I think all of you understand that, looking at each individual and making that care meet their needs, that should drive up that process all the time. Advocacy, which all of us also work on every day for our clients. And communication, and that's the piece I want you to remember when we talk about the interaction between the care manager for OPG, Office of the Public Guardian, and Adult Protective Services, because that those are the people you'll be interacting with. And it's so key to keep that communication clear and flowing, and that's how we can best serve our clients. I want to get back to the team. Helen Dodd, the acting public guardian for the state of New Jersey, has over 1,300 clients or wards of the state. So once someone has been deemed incapacitated and the judge assigns them to the Office of the Public Guardian, Helen is responsible as acting public guardian. Because of that number, it's unrealistic that she could be involved in every aspect of every person at every minute, although she pretty much, in my opinion, is. But we have a team, and the team all has responsibilities that have been delegated and shared, and they report and they represent, they report to and represent Helen Dodd. So for your information, knowing that the care manager, who's one person on this interdisciplinary team, that's your point person. The care manager is who you're going to be connecting with. And that care manager is going to take concerns or issues to the different people on the team and all the way up the chain to Helen as needed. The team consists of a care manager, who is generally someone who looks at social and medical needs, an attorney, a property investigator, someone who works with just the financial aspect, accountant, and nurses. So we have a great broad team approach that I think is amazingly effective and very helpful for each client. The other thing I just want to stress, because it is important for you to know that the care manager is also sometimes referred to or will sign consents and documents as the guardian representative for OPG, or Office of the Public Guardian. So I try to educate people as much as possible, because when they see me in the nursing home or wherever I'm going in the community, that's the guardian, they'll say, you're her guardian. So I try to explain a little bit about what I just told you, that I am a guardian representative